Hello friends, welcome to the Edisat Network. Our today's topic of discussion is Indo-Persian culture and Mughal court. And for this discussion, we have this in the studio, Dr. Chandrasekhar, head and professor in Department of Persian, University of Delhi. He is also a member of the Committee for the Translation of Persian Works of National Importance under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India, New Delhi, 2011 onwards. He is also a UGC nominee, DRS CAS program, Department of Persian, University of Kashmir, Srinagar, Jammu and Kashmir, and also a member on the Board of Studies, undergraduate and postgraduate, 2009 onwards. And also his recent publication is named Persian Manuscripts, Studies in Culture, Literature and the Arts, published in 2013. And of course, you would get to know more about him as we go on with the lecture. But with this, let us welcome sir today. Thank you for coming, sir. Thank you. Welcome and welcome to our Edisat Network. And we request you to begin our today's lecture.
Thank you and welcome to all. Today's topic, Indo-Persian, is a term coined long back, and in recent past, another term associated with this culture is called Persianate culture. A wide range of works have been done on both the terms in various disciplines of art and culture as well as literature. The last one, the literature, is a major corpus for the study of both the terms. When we say Indo-Persian culture, that means as a assimilation of two great cultures, that Indian culture as well as the Persianate culture. Many of you definitely know about ancient India, its culture, languages, and the development throughout those centuries which we associate with ancient Indian culture. The other part is Persianate culture. Persianate culture's geography is also has been very wide, from Georgia, Tbilisi to Lahore. Long back from Arab Peninsula to again back to Quetta in present Pakistan. When Greeks invaded Persian Empire of Achaemenid in 4th century BC, who destroyed a large area and burned down Persepolis and established their rule in that great land. Consequently, there arrived Greek culture too. In 3rd century AD, Iranians regained the empire and established the famous Sassanid dynasty. In 7th century, with the advent of Islam, Arabs arrived as the crusaders of Islam and Islamic power. Following the same phenomena, ethnic forces of Minor Asia, especially Turks, Uzbeks and Tajik, started raiding Indian sites to establish Islamic rule in 11th and 12th century. This is the beginning. This is the beginning of a new cultural phenomena which arrived with these Islamic forces. The term Persian is associated with it. One should also know that they were not only the Persians. They may be from the Persian culture. They are the ethnic groups of Turks, Uzbeks, Tajiks, as well as the Mongols, who all were deeply influenced by, in fact, Persian culture. And when larger Persian culture was adopted earlier at the Ghuris and the Ghaznavid courts in Minor Central Asia, that is Ghazna and Ghori, which are both today in Afghanistan, the same cultural elements also arrived with them when they arrived in late 11th and 12th century in India and established Islamic power first in Lahore and then in Delhi. And then its offshoots went towards Bengal and then spread through various centuries in the different parts. In this area, we can define many vistas. In fact, part of culture and part of court culture especially has different factors. When we say the different factors of the court culture, the first is called the etiquettes and the customs which are prevalent in the Delhi Sultanate court. Initially, Islamic customs were also introduced, which was the core element behind the establishment of this empire in India, in fact. But along with that, particularly like in the empire of Balban, the old Persian culture, which was prevalent in Sassanid court or prior to that in Achaemenid court, was also introduced in Delhi Sultanate's Balban court. One may find many instances of this, like Zameen Bosi, earth kissing, or Paw Bosi, the feet touching or feet kissing, or the celebrations of Nowruz, the ancient Iranian festival, which is even today in Iranian as well as the Persian cultural dominant countries like Tajikistan or Uzbekistan or others. One can observe the forbiddenness of its celebration throughout those lands. The same culture was also introduced at Delhi Sultanate court. Along with it, the same kind of a revenue system, the same kind of administration which was in Sassanid court was also introduced in Delhi Sultanate. One should also know that the same culture was earlier introduced at the Abbasid court at Baghdad. Majority of the wazirs or the prime ministers of the Abbasids were in fact Iranians, and many were also from the Indian origin. The famous Barmakis, the word Barmak was from Parmukh, and they were from the Parmukhs of the Buddhist Viharas who had later on embraced Islam, in fact. And with the system which was established at Baghdad court, the same cue was taken and reintroduced at the Balban's court also. In such a style, these things were introduced, and we find that many vistas which were of close Iranian cultural dominance, we find in them wall engravings on the staircase of Persepolis near Shiraz, and one of the paintings at Ajanta show the close proximity of Indo-Iranian culture. And one can see the kind of the close proximity between Pahlavi language as well as the Sanskrit language. Many words like Abra, Asp, Ashva. One can go on a long list where one can see the close kind of affinity between both these languages. When in Balban's court this culture was reintroduced, he also named his many offsprings and their sons also with the first word of Kiani dynasty of Iran. Kaim is great, like Kaikobad, Kaikhusro, while Khusro itself means king. Khaljin and Tughlaq continued the same, also encouraged the amalgamation of Indian elements. We know Amir Khusro as a pioneer of Indian culture in Persian literature. We call him the first poet of Hindi language also, as in one of his poetical collections, Introduction of Ghurrat al-Kumal, he says that he has penned down poetry in three languages, and amongst one is Hindi also. Likewise, he is a pioneer to introduce Indian culture in his poetical works. His works like Dolani Khazar Khan, Kiranu Sadan, No Sipar are full of many Indian elements, and even No Sipar, he tried to establish the supremacy of India over all other cultures, its languages. He mentions about language of language Sanskrit, Vedas, and many other Indian arts in that. He becomes emotional when he explains all these things. And he even says that he will prefer to live in this one. And he says that Adam was first arrived on this land, not on any other land. On one end, Persian, though it was not a language of religion, but a language of governance, began to become tool of every subject, as well as absorbing the local cultural terms of many aspects which did not have the Persian equivalents. In many cases, Hindi words were Persianized. Khusro even Persianized the word Devaldehi to Devalrani. According to him, the word Deval has a component Dev, and in Persian, Dev means demon. So one should not keep the word Deval. He Persianized it and said Dual, which is the plural of Daulat, the governance, the wealth. In Ejaz-e Khusravi, a compendium of ornate Persian writing, he explains again many aspects including music and mention about the musical instruments of India. And one of those instruments were Kinkar also. He is advocating the supremacy of Indian culture in all his best. His innovative poetry made him popular in his own life time, not only in India but also in Persian-speaking regions. One may compartmentalize the cross-cultural effects and from some specific areas, court customs, traditions, etiquettes, musical assemblies, literary gatherings, dresses or the textiles, all part of the court culture. We find a variety of references in Persian literature about it. We find that Chanderi's cloth, a place which was first conquered by Sultan Alauddin Khilji in 1290s when he was on his way to Devgir. In Akbarnama, it is mentioned that 13,000 mosques were in Chanderi at that time. In fact, these were the centers of the weaving. We know that the Bagh River, which flows close to that vicinity, and its black soil is the major source of cotton production. And even today, Chanderi's cloth of variety arrive in various exhibitions and people buy it with all their fondness. Till the time of Aurangzeb, all the elite class dresses were from the Chanderi cloth, in fact. Curtains were from the same textile, same fabrics. It is a fact that in medieval times, court has acquired a central stage of all the activities. The king's personage take forward or even backwards or in other meaning, discourages development of cultural vistas. This is the reason many treatises written in Persian, like the first chapter of Gulistan Saadi or the counsels of Balban to his son, the martyred son Mahmud Khan, on the governance system, show how kings had taken deep interest not only in the governance but also in the court culture prior to the Mughal rule in India. Amongst the Indo-Persian cultural vistas at the royal courts, marriages or marriage ceremonies are the one which incorporated the whole cultural assimilation factors. Amir Khusro's work, like Dawlati Khizr Khan, is one such example from the royal marriage saga to the marriage ceremonies held at the court of Jahangir, Shah Jahan, Farrukh Siyar, Muhammad Shah, and Asif Jah, and others too. All these show how the marriage ceremonies have been as celebrated with all their fervidness at the Mughal court. And we know that these marriages were quite different from the Central Asian marriage system, in fact. This one marriage illustration which one can see is from the Persian manuscript from Central Asian one. One can observe that these kind of the marriage celebrations were very wide in Central Asia and even today, which has a close again nose to the celebration of Nowruz festival, in fact. One can observe that the glass which is also kept and the kind of the fruits and the musical instruments which are being played on, and as well as the candle lights, different dry fruits, these were the major parts which are also in the celebrations in Nowruz festival. But when we see the festival or the marriage ceremonies at Indian courts, we find many other items which are not found in the Iranian marriage celebrations, in fact. In National Museum, there is a manuscript known as Tuzuk-e Asif Jahi, and which is a history of Mir Nizam Ali Khan's period especially. And in the same one, we find an illustration of the Shiraz school, and which shows how the marriage celebration were taking place. They show all kind of the variety of dresses, animals decked with the all different aspects, as well as they also show the variety of atishbazi or the fireworks in that also. In the same manner, another illustration which is kept in National Museum show how Dara Shikoh's marriage was celebrated. We also know that his first marriage with the Asif Khan's daughter, and its engagement took place at Lahore in the presence of Jahangir, in fact. And there was a tradition that the city of Hisar, which is presently in Haryana, was a Jagir from the time of Humayun, which was first given to him when Babur was coming to, in fact, conquer Agra and Delhi. From that time till Aurangzeb, it continued as a Jagir. On the occasion of the engagement of Dara Shikoh, that city was also given as a Jagir to Humayun, and later on, to Dara Shikoh, in fact, by Shah Jahan, as a tradition in the royal court. The other vista which we find in the court etiquettes, apart from the marriage ceremonies, is the musical assemblies, and also the receiving of the many ambassadors or the personages of the various aspects, including the saints. The same tradition we find that it continued in also the regional painting schools. There is a masnavi or the long narrative poetry manuscript, namely as a masnavi naqid at Salar Jung Museum. Interestingly, many Indian stories from the ancient India, especially from Mahabharata, were recomposed with some additional additions, as well as some new elements of both the cultures, and they were also depicted in the visuals also. This is one of the illustration in which it is shown that Raja Chatramukh, who in the dress of a sagacious person arrived at a Gujarat's court, where he wanted to marry, in fact, the daughter of that Raja, in fact. And he had arrived as a trader, not as a Raja, and had shown himself that he is interested only in the selling the goods. These kind of illustration of the regional code, basically from the Golconda area or the Golconda painting school, show that all these elements which were derived from the central school of painting, that is the Mughal painting also, had the same kind of effects. The Persian blue color, which you can see in the background of that, or the red crimson color carpet, were the same elements which we found in the main or the Mughal central painting school, in fact, of the particularly from the Jahangir's period onwards. We also know that many painters who were brought from Iran, particularly with Humayun, and later on under Shah Jahan and Jahangir arrived, like in Jahangir's period, Nadiruzzaman, the famous painter who arrived, and he was trained at Jahangir's court, and he was also asked to make number of portraits of Jahangir, and lived up to the time of Shah Jahan. He made such many illustrations or the paintings in which one can see different ambassadors who are arriving at the court of Jahangir or later on in Shah Jahan's period, and they were painted in the portrait. The third aspect which we see among the Indo-Persian culture is basically the architecture. This is a factor that in which many kinds of assimilations took place. One can see the kind of lotus at the top of Taj Mahal or many other buildings which show the Indo-Persian culture, the Jharoka system, again the same Indo-Persian culture and Indian element, which one cannot find in any building of the Central Asia or Iranian peninsula, in fact. However, different kind of the purely Persianate architectural aspects were also brought. In earlier stages, we see the Mehrab system was closely to ancient Indian architecture system. But later on, the Iranian Mehrabs, like the Mehrab of the Masjid al-Lutfullah or the many others, were brought, and the central Mehrab was more closely to the Iranian mosque system. That shows that the Masons from Iranian peninsula were brought, and they were the instrumental in this kind of a Islamic architecture or Indo-Islamic architecture particularly. One another aspect which was also patronized by Mughal court is the art of bookmaking. Art of bookmaking got prominence for many reasons. In every royal library, there was an atelier in which, apart from painting, books were compiled. The book compilation or the art of bookmaking is that there was a complete procedure how to write a book or the copies of those books were to be made. We know the maximum number of manuscripts, the handwritten books, to which we call manuscripts, are Quran Sharif. And next to that is a Persian book, that is Shahnama. Throughout the world, the majority of the manuscripts are from this book of Firdausi, who had compiled it at the court of Mahmud Ghaznavi. There is a long story behind its compilation also, and it is said that Mahmud of Ghazna had promised him to give a handsome kind of a price for its one, but he did not keep his word, and he sent that amount only the time when Firdausi had died and his corpse was taken for burying, in fact. However, number of copies of Shahnama are Indian libraries. There are 28 manuscript copies at National Museum, New Delhi itself. Many of these are highly illustrated. And interestingly, the manuscript copies of Shahnama, which were copied here in Indian various courts, especially at the Mughal courts, and later on in 18th century, even at the court of Ranjit Singh, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, the content are from Shahnama, but the illustrations are from Maharaja Ranjit Singh. That show how we have incorporated our own Indian imaginations also in the Persian works. In fact, likewise, many Indian stories like Nal Damayanti, which was first composed by Faizi at the court of Akbar, we have innumerable manuscripts also from this work. And the kind of illustrations, as you have seen the illustration from this Masri Naqid, are purely from the Indian culture. The dresses you see, the kind of the malas or the kind of the chains men are putting in their neck are purely from the Indian culture. In fact, there are many Persian artists also who not only sketched or portrayed the Muslim saints or the Muslim kings, they also portrayed the Indian saints also, or the many other places of the ancient Indian culture. There was a competition like scenario at the Mughal court, especially from the time of Akbar. One can see a variety of the comparative religious studies were made in that period. There is a book called Dabistan-e-Mazahib, which reveals the all characteristics of the all religions. And this writer of this book has tried to focus on each and every sampradaya or every maslak of every religion also. The last one which I would like to highlight is also the Persian poetry. When we say Persian poetry composed in India, it is not only the similes and metaphors which are brought from Persianate culture. As I mentioned in my earlier submission, that there are many works which were introduced by Amir Khusro as the Indian culture. But we can say that Amir Khusro was an Indian born poet. But from the time of Mughals, innumerable Iranians or people from the Persian speaking regions came to Indian courts, and not only at the court of Mughals, many of them arrived at Deccan court from the Bahmani period, from in Qutb Shahi, Adil Shahi, and even up to Asif Jahi's one. Many works were written by them or in their presence, even by the kings. We know about the Noras. The word Noras has about 80 meanings. And the work Noras is also by Ibrahim Adil Shah, is a compilation of Indian music. In the same manner, later on, like Muhammad Shah compiled a work like Nadirat-e-Shahi, again on purely on Indian music. These Persian poetry are not merely on Ghazal or Masnavi. There is a huge corpus also in the poetic form, the musicological aspects. There is a book called Ghunnit al-Munniya, which was compiled in Gujarat in late 13th or 14th century, used to be considered as the first work in Persian to introduce ancient Indian musical system. It is interesting that it is compiled in Gujarat. Later on, we also know that Sharangdev had moved from Kashmir to Devgir, another milestone beginning from Deccan, and which was the first one conquered by Sultan Alauddin Khilji. Many people know that Sarangdev's work Man Kotuhal is the first one in this arena of musicology. Sarangdev's work was continuously a source for the Persian musical treatises. Many works were compiled on the basis of this one, like Raag Darpan, which was compiled by Fakirullah, in 18th century is the translation of the same, which is retransmitted by Professor Shahab Sarmadi of Aligarh and published by IGNCA. These works are in Persian script. Majority of the contents are from Hindi or the other vernacular language. Many works have not been edited yet, and these are the sources for knowing the specific Hindustani music, which is again a kind of icon of Indo-Persian culture basically. The another aspect of which we have discussed some issues only is the Sufic culture, which emerged as also an assimilation of Indian philosophy as well as some Islamic elements, and behind that also there is a Buddhist philosophy. We know that the Buddhism traveled from India towards Central Asia via Afghanistan, and even today in many places in Afghanistan, even at the border of Uzbekistan, there is a place called Tirmiz. A huge monastery's ruin one can see over there. And as I mentioned earlier, in Abbasid dynasty, the Barmakis or the Wazirs, they were basically the Buddhist in fact. They were the Parmukhs or the chiefs of the Viharas. So it was very obvious that the Buddhist philosophy also had an impact on the inverted commas, the Sufi philosophy. The renowned poet Abdul Qadir Bedil, Azimabadi's works, which are full of philosophical aspects, has component of all these three, the Buddhism, Islamic, as well as the ancient Indian philosophy or the Hindu Darshan. When the assimilation took place, a large arena came up. We know Hazrat Muinuddin Chishti arrived first. He is one of the first Sufi who established centers in Indian land, that is at Ajmer. And later on, many Sufi maslaks arrived, amongst that the Naqshbandis, Chishtis, Hazrat Muinuddin, Hazrat Nizamuddin Awliya, who all belong to Chishtiya sect of Sufis, or the Naqshbandis or the Shattaris or the Firdausiyars and many others. All of them in many parts of greater India, not only present India, they established their centers like the Sohrawardis in present Pakistan's many places, or Khaja Gesudraz at Deccan. They all had interaction with the local masses, irrespective of their caste, creed or religion in fact. Even today it is a fact that the majority of the devotees of these Sufic centers are from the local masses without considering their religion or their caste and creed. This was the phenomena which boosted for the promotion of the harmony and secular culture, as well as the promotion of Indo-Persian culture in various aspects. The Sufic treatises, which are compiled either by the disciples of the great Sufis like Fawadul Fawad or many other, all these are full of different kind of the anecdotes which show that the assemblies at the Sufic centers were in fact a kind of a new beginning of a new culture from 13th century onwards, which is fortunately even beginning, which is in vogue today also. All these aspects, right from music or the dance assemblies at the various courts, we also know the Kathak was also a genre of Indian dance system emerged from this kind of a Indo-Persian music system or the Indian dance system. These all aspects leads us to believe that there were various vistas which became the focal points for this kind of a phenomena to which we call Indo-Persian culture. In fact, one can read different aspects from the different views, but one comes to this kind of a conclusion that there was an assimilation of a culture which was towards inside this boundary and the culture which was from that boundary, and there were only the boundaries of various ethnic groups which had their own culture, and these are defined by various forms. There is a one work which can be also called as an icon of this Indo-Persian culture. It is an encyclopedic dictionary by Anandram Mukhlis of Muhammad Shah's period, namely Miratul Istilah, the mirror of terms. Interestingly, in 18th century, he is compiling a work on the basis of the cultural and the governance terms of Iran and India and giving a comparative statement. Like one example I gave, even today in the various parts of India, especially in the remote villages, we see when a person rides either a tanga or some this kind of vehicle and want to move out, the family members pour water on the wheel of the tanga or the others to say goodbye to him and to come back with all his welfare. The same tradition we can find even today in Iran or Persian culture. These kind of the common cultural phenomena helped each other to understand each other and to live together. This harmony, which is the core of this Indo-Persian culture, the prem or the love, which was also the core issue of the bhakti movement, all these issues became together and allowed a culture or allowed a making of the culture to emerge as a kind of a not lingua franca, cultura franca throughout India, and it is Indo-Persian culture. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the very descriptive and also illustrated lecture that we had today. And from within that, let us ask sir a few doubts that the students would also be thinking of. Sir, you mentioned at the beginning two terms, Indo-Persian and Persianate. Sir, could you clarify the two terms, the difference between the two?
When we say Persianate culture, we study from beginning of the this northwest or the Afghans up to Tbilis in Moscow. In fact, we know from the ancient time, from the Achaemenid period, who started from the 8th century and came down up to the 4th century when Alexander had conquered Persia, in fact. But when the same culture arrived in India, as I mentioned, in 11th, 12th century onwards with the establishment of the Islamic Empire, and they were also highly influenced by that Persianate culture. When the same one arrived in India and its offshoot with the assimilation of Indian culture became the Indo-Persian culture.
Right. Okay, so that makes it Indo-Persian culture.
Yeah.
Right. Sir, and then I would also like to ask you, say…
Sorry to intervene. When we say like Hindustani music, we do not use the word Indo-Persian music.
Right.
We use the word Hindustani music.
Right.
But we don't call Hindustani music to the our pure ancient Indian music.
Yes.
We call it Shastriya Sangeet.
Yes.
We don't call it a Hindustani music. Hindustani music is another offshoot of this Indo-Persian culture, basically. And all these kind of the genres of Tarana, Qaul, Qawwali, all these also assimilated in Shastriya Sangeet. And even like Dhrupad, which was a purely a religious genre to be sung at the temples only. When it came out of that confined area, it also became a part of this Hindustani music.
Right. So you also mentioned that Kathak had emerged from the Indo-Persian culture.
We know that the Kathak is a genre which narrates a story kind of thing.
Yes.
And a dancing form was given
yes.
to it. It is true that various kind of a genre in music, especially the performing music, the dance music we had, rather Kathakali you have in South,
yes.
which is again a narrative of a story.
Yes.
Kathak is also of the same kind, but with that, if you see, a kind of the Persian dancing, stepping were also assimilated with that, and it became a separate genre with that.
Okay, so then it became Kathak.
Yeah.
That way.
Okay. Kathak is from the Katha.
Katha, yes.
And this say, like in Sanskrit and Pahalvi, because it is said that it is from the one root. The suffix ka is basically also for the shorter one, diminutive form. Like
right.
you have the word pustak. Pustak is also word pust plus ka. Pust is also deformed of word pusht. Pusht is the back. If you see our back, it is like a book. It has a spine. And it has this one.
Okay, all right. So thank you for telling us so much in depth about that. And sir, you talked about etiquettes and customs in detail in the Delhi Sultanate court. So could we?
I couldn't show you the illustration. In fact, we know. There was a particular kind of the court system. Many European travelers mentioned that people were not able to look face to face to the king like Jahangir. There was a system in which lines the nobles of according to their hierarchy will sit. There is a renowned book called Tarikh-e-Baihaqi of the Ghaznavid Empire by Abul Fazl Baihaqi. He gives a complete picture of the Ghaznavid court system, how it was. In the same work, he explains an anecdote. A minister who wanted the Masood Ghaznavi not to become the king, and he tried to in fact make a conspiracy, he should not become the king. But however, he became king and this minister was pardoned. But he was not allowed to come and sit in the main court. He was given a place outside the court.
Right.
So, what is the sitting system in the court? How the submission or the presentation of the works were given? As I mentioned about the art of bookmaking,
yes.
on every manuscript which was a part of the royal library, you will find a kind of a seal on which the words are arz dide shud. That means whatever is presented has been observed.
Right.
This kind of presentation or any kind of gift which used to be brought in the court, there was a procedure to present it. And it will go to the royal treasure, it will
right.
go to the royal library, and there was a particular system of making its inventory. Even today in our library system, you know there is a stamp like called checked.
Yes.
That is a physical system. So there was also a system. And how many inventories were made? I hope many of people who are listening this one or watching this program, they would have seen different kinds of farmans. There are various nomenclatures, Farman, Nishan, Parwana, or many others like that. On back of every Farman, there is a reference to the context. The reason for which the Farman is prepared, the reason is written on the back of the letter, not on the front of the letter. So this reference to the context in every this kind of the royal edict, one can see the script may be very ornamental on the very face of it, on the front side, on which you find in bit on the top of one is called the Thogra, which is a red colored stamp kind of the thing, which has the name of the king also.
Okay.
That is again a part of the Indian culture. The color, the word you have all, you go from Lucknow onwards, even today people use the word alta.
Yes, they do. Yes.
They put, even the male members put on the foot. Yes. In the different celebration, the word al is called for red, in fact.
Red.
The same red color, which was a sign of the royal signature, were put on the farmans, in fact. So these kind of a court governance system, how a presentation will be made, or how the king will pass his order, and how, there is a word called Bandagane Hazrat. In Bandagane Hazrat, every farman is written in the passive form and the third person name. It is never written in the first one. The king doesn't say I, it is always he. That shows the kind also the submissiveness. So this kind of a culture continued, which we call today the Lakshmi culture. Aap,
right.
Aap aaye.
Yes.
The same kind of things. Or if you go to Hyderabad, or you go to Bhopal, we have the same. Even in Delhi, we say to ourselves, Banda, aapke khidmat mein hazir hai.
Yes.
This is the same kind of a phrases continue to welcome someone, to show one's all humbleness. So this kind of a cultural etiquettes were part of the court culture, in fact.
Right. So you also mentioned musical assemblies that were held in the court. Can we talk a bit about that? What was the nature and what was the usual conduct in these musical assemblies?
Especially in the court, the whole timing were divided into different ghadis.
Okay.
And there are particular two ghadi time, like in the Shahjahan's time, which were for this kind of a musical assemblies. Even in some cases, when the king is totally attentive to one particular performance, he can exceed on the time. I remember in one of the contexts of Shahjahanama by Qazvini, an anecdote is mentioned that Shahjahan continued to listen to the musical performance, a vocal music particularly. The person who used to remind the king that the time of this musical hour has been over, the king said, I know what I had to do in the next 2 hours. I had finished already some part of that in my previous ghadis, and let me continue it.
Okay.
This was a part of the musical assemblies in all the courts. Except Aurangzeb, though in initial period he was also fond of it. And it's also interesting that we say, or the many such books are saying, that Aurangzeb was purely against it, and an anecdote was also mentioned. But it is also interesting, many musical treatises were compiled at the court of Aurangzeb, or in the time of Aurangzeb.
Right.
In the these assemblies, one can find the instrumental, vocal and dance, all these three. And these musical treatises which were compiled in this period also speak about all these three. The manners in which the sitting should take place, the kind of the musical instruments will be used, or even there is a big discussion and or the discourse on the sitar in almost everyone. But it is According to Munir Lahori, who was a court poet of Shah Jahan, it is an innovative musical instrument of Veena. It is not a setar, which is mentioned in Persian poetical system. Their instrument is quite different from this one. The innovativeness may be over there. Many people have the different beliefs. And music is one which is from mouth to mouth. You will find lesser works on this aspect in comparison to history or others.
Right.
So these assemblies were part of the court culture, and we know various kind of the epithets were given to the renowned musical illuminaries of that period, right from Nayak Bakshu to Tansen, and even in the time of Muhammad Shah. There is a book called Murakkai Delhi, which I translated long back in English, in fact. It is the 18th century socio-cultural history of Delhi, and in one part of that, all kind of a musicians, from vocal, from instrumental, and even the dancers, like Noorbai, who was a dancer at the court of Muhammad Shah, and to whom Nader Shah wanted to take her along with him to Iran, in fact. However, on the intervention of Muhammad Shah, she was spared, in fact. These assemblies were the essential part. In the same manner, as the hunting was also a kind of the routine work of a kings, in fact.
Right.
So, music played an important role in all the musical assemblies held at the court.
Right, right, definitely, sir. And very briefly, sir, we can talk about the fabrics that were used. You had mentioned that chanderi was used very often by the emperors as a mode of dressing, the fabric of chanderi.
Chanderi, devgir. You will find different kind of the terms for them. And even not only in Akbarnama or Ayn Akbari, many works explain this, like I mentioned about this Tuzuki Asif Jahi. He explains about the different terms of this one. Many Persian poets, in fact, we talk about Kabir many times,
yes,
that he terms. But in Persian, like Khakani, who was a renowned poet of the Seljuk period of Iran, he uses all textile terminology. Or you have many other Indian Persian works in which you will find that the specific terms which are mentioned for it, and these may have gone into oblivion today, but at one time they were part of this one. In fact, these were sent as the gifts, and even when Mahmud Ghaznavi had gone from here, he had not only taken gold and other precious metals with it. He had taken away the best textiles also from him. So, and these were the part of the export items from India, in fact.
Right. So,
Burhanpur was like a center. Recently, I edited a work, namely as a memoirs of Asad Beg Kazwini, who was a courtier with Abul Fazl. He mentioned that from Burhanpur, not only the metal works, or the arms, like particularly talwar, textiles are being exported.
Right.
And because we know the land from this Tapti river from Surat towards its a place of emergence, all this is the best cotton production area.
Right, right. Well, sir, we'll have to cut short our discussion because we have come to the close of the lecture, but it was definitely a very interesting and also a very fruitful discussion that we had, and also a very wonderful lecture on Indo-Persian culture and Mughal court by sir. So, let us thank him for being here, and with this we would like to close the lecture and wish you all a wonderful day. Have a wonderful day, and we hope to see you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. To all.